participatorily establishing cosmopolitanism, a choric Iberian extravaganza, songs about Spain, rousingly rendered by Mr. Clifton Todd, plus the Players Theatre!
My future wife. Was at the bullfight that we met him. We've been watching his daring display. And while we nipped out for some nuts and a program, the dirty dog stole our way. Oh yes!
Oh yes!
Oh yes!
Oh yes!
But tonight we will have our revenge. When
we catch Alfonso Spagoli, the Tory of Doctor.
With one mighty swipe, we would dislocate his body joke. La 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 la. We'll all find this bullfighter, so we will. And when we catch the finder of lighter, we'll kill. He shall die.
He shall die.
He shall die. He shall die. Till he I die, 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 die. He shall die. He shall die. Oh, we'll raise a bunion on his Spanish onion if we catch him. All the things they do go on so in the land of King Alfonso. They are somewhat of a rum lot, and the best thing I can say is Pontilion, 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 Pontilion.
Atlanticism! Threnodic! From Threnody. Saltatory ostentation! American song and dance! Welcome back to Mr. Peter Gale!
Down in Georgia, there are peaches waiting for ya. Yes, and each is sweet as any peach that you could reach for on a tree. Southern beauties, they are famous. Georgia's where they grow. My folks write me, they invite me. Don't you want to go? Everything is peaches down in Georgia. What a peach of a climb for a peach of a time. Believe me, paradise is waiting down there for ya. I've got a peach of a paw, a peach of a maw. Oh, what a peach of a couple they are. Cousins, why, I have dozens. And if you saw them, I know you'd adore them. I bet you pick yourself a peach of a wife, settle down to a peach of a life. Everything is peaches down in Georgia. All of Georgia's full of peaches, they're all gorgeous. Each one reaches right into your heart and makes you part of Georgia too. Clingstone peaches cling right to ya. Peaches haunt your dream. Think of getting, always getting peaches in your cream.
Sick of them. No introduction from me. His music seems to tell it all. In 1912, he fell madly in love with the daughter of another songwriter. They married, but after their honeymoon in Cuba, she fell ill and died. It was this despair that brought about this glorious song, When I Lost You.
Continentally, idolized, intrepidity of equilibristic equipoise, acrobats, late running! hilariously harmonious multiplicity, melodious vociferative, virtuosity, the King's Sinner!
Didn't have no streamlined trains, but they had lonely country lanes when power scored in Ma. Didn't have no ritzy bars, fancy drinks or caviars, but they had lots of moon and stars when power scored in Ma. Didn't have no commentators or a news broadcast. They'd listen on the party line and get the news darn near as fast. Didn't have no electric light, just by lamp they spoon all night, but still in all they did all right when power's called in Ma. They had no Opry at the Met, hadn't heard of Verdi yet, but all that barbershop quartet.
Sweet Adeline.
Sweet Adeline. They did have fun, they never missed a single Huskin bee. And get back home, they'd steal a kiss and Pard say gosh and Maud say gee. Most important thing somehow, you'll admit and they'll allow that love was love the same as now when power scored in Ma. By heck, how they could neck when power's scored in
Ma.
My dear old Ma.
Pierce, Tom Pierce, Lindoy the grey mare.
Hold along down along out the long lee.
For us once for to go over to Widdicombe Fair with Bill Brewer,
Peter Gurney,
dear Lady Darwin.
Harry O,
old Uncle Tom Cobley and all. Old Uncle Tom Cobley and all.
And when July's again the grey mare, all along down along out the long lee.
By Friday noon or Saturday soon, with Bill Brewer,
Chester,
Peter Gurney,
dear Lady Darwin.
Harry Oak,
old Uncle Tom Cobley and all.
Old Uncle Tom Cobley and all.
Then Friday came and Saturday noon,
all along down along out the long lee.
But Tom's old mare had not trotted home,
with Bill Brewer,
Chester,
Peter Gurney,
dear Lady
Darwin. Harry Oak,
old Uncle Tom Cobley and all. Old Uncle Tom Cobley and all.
Then Tom Pierce went up to the top of the hill.
Old and long out and long lee.
And he zeed his old mare down, making her will.
And Tommy sat down on a stone and he cried.
With Bill Brewer,
John Stewart,
Peter Gurney,
Peter Davy,
carry on.
Old Uncle Tom Cobley and
Cobley and all. Old Uncle Tom Cobley and all.
When the wind whistles cold on the moor of a night,
all along down along out the long lee,
Tom Pierce's old mare doth appear ghastly white.
Just you, Billy,
darling, Harry
Oak. Old Uncle Tom Cobley and
Uncle Tom Cobley, old Uncle Tom Cobley.
And all the long night be it skirling and groans, all along
down along out along lee,
from Tom Pierce's old mare and a rattling of bones.
John Stewart,
Peter Gurney,
Peter Davy,
Tom Whitten,
old Uncle Tom Cobley and old Uncle Tom Cobley.
Bobby. And
you!
Long neck, don't call me at all. That's all!
Lugubriousness in extremis, the one and only Mr. Les Dawson!
Thank you for your approbation. You have excellent taste. Firstly, I must apologize about my appearance. Owing to a slight financial hiatus, I could not afford a ticket to travel here tonight by steam locomotion. I had to walk it. A journey, my friends, best described as a stroll around the very perimeter of Hades itself. Fingers of cold mountain mist curled in treachery around my stout Gannix gaiters. As I toiled heavily across the bleak plateau of the mountain range, a sullen biting wind blew the snow flurries into a maddened fandango of white flake fury. Of age-pitted stones loomed an ill-painted door. Crying sanctuary through cracked lips, I lurched forward and banged painfully on the door. The door opened to reveal the most enchanting little girl that I've ever seen. Aww. My child, I croaked. May I speak to your father? The winsome gamin gazed at me and said,
Daddy isn't here.
Then, child, I explained, may I have words with your dear mother? A troubled look came across her features. Her bottom lip trembled. A fleeting shadow of sadness crossed her features.
She said, Mummy isn't here either.
Aww. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I too could not believe it. I railed inwardly at the perfidy of parents who could abandon such a delightful waif, leave this child alone in such a small, cramped, gloomy house, in the teeth of a ferocious storm, in this mist of desolation. I could contain myself no longer. Sinking to my knees, I grasped the child to my snow-powdered cape. I said, fear not, my child, elfin creature of pure delight. Fear not, for you are no longer alone. And she grasped her rag dolly very close to her little pinafore and she said,
it's not the house, it's the lavatory.
For those of you who are unfamiliar with the works of a tragic actor, I should like to introduce myself. The name is Les Dawson. It's not my real name, it's a stage name. Because I was actually christened Friday Dawson. Because when Father saw me for the first time, he turned to Mother and said, I think we better call it a day. I've made such an impact on my parents' lives. Before I was born, Father and had a nasty habit of running off and leaving Mother for months on end. But when I came on the scene, they gazed at me in the crib, held hands and ran off together. Such was the pattern of my earlier years. I seldom speak of my childhood unless somebody's buying the drinks. It was not a happy time. Is that a violin? No, it isn't. It's the frustrated wail of a doctored tom. Yes. You think you've known tragedy? For a start, I wasn't expected. Mother was firmly convinced she was going in hospital to have a boy lanced. Looking back in retrospective thought, I must have looked a mess because the first job my father did when they brought me home was put shutters on my pram. He made no secret of the fact that he didn't like me. He used to play some rotten tricks on me. Yes. Like telling me for years the gas meter was a piggy bank. Mummy was short-sighted. And she would persist in keeping in talcum powder on my face. Between you and I, I've often shuddered to think what she did with me dummy. It wasn't easy for my parents. We were a big family, a lot of children. In fact, there were so many wet nappies in the kitchen, there was a rainbow in the lobby. But there is to posterity one iota that he left, which will never die. And that was the fact that Father was a wonderful mountaineer, famous for once having been trapped 23,000 feet at the side of Mount Everest on a 2-inch ledge, carrying his lame mule to safety. On the back of a plasterer's hod. Face it, dear friends, you and I would have panicked. He didn't, he fell off. Some people appreciate my work. This letter arrived in the dressing room not so long ago, tied with pink ribbon to a coping stone. Little Bo Peep has lost her sheep and don't know where to find them. What piffle! Because you know where she would have found them? She was in a meadow with Simple Simon. And he wasn't so simple. He was having it off. What the world is now is love, love, love. Ooh. I must stop this. Every time I put these glasses on, a hideous doppelganger takes over. This is the letter. It's very emotive. It will move you to tears. But it's very simply, dear Mr. Dawson, but the way she spelt dear, D-E-A-R. You have done more for me than any specialist could ever hope to do. For years I have suffered from acute insomnia. My nights of bed were a restless misery. Sleep, the soothing balm, eluded me. I've had treatment all over the world, in Europe, Zurich, Rill, Tamworth. To no avail. But to you, dear Mr. Dawson, you have cured me. I saw you on the good old days and I couldn't keep my eyes open. My goodness.
Apotheosis of plethoric, proliferative profusion. Lots and lots. Dinari! There's just time to ask Mr. Les Dawson to lead the company and yourselves in the last chorus for tonight down at the Old Bull and Bush. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Les Dawson and the entire company, Mr. Bernard Herman and the entire and undaunted orchestra.